Today, it's going to be a little bit of an extension of the talk we did a year we've got the conference in the Hunter Valley. So we're getting all started. We're getting started. Okay, so we've got the beginnings. We'll talk through the primary focus of our practice is computer technology and the systems of delivery approach. We'll talk about transaction costs and our lack of a marketing fee, which is something we'd like to invest in. So the four of us grew up with founders. Chris Haddad and myself grew up in Hobart. Chris Gilbert and John Clark grew up in country Victoria, about a town apart, interestingly enough. And so we're very much, you'll see, inspired by the landscape and so forth. So the business has three areas of focus. We've got the architecture, obviously, but we're also quite involved in products, and we like to see a bit of the education community. The two Chris's used to, not so much this year, do quite a lot of mentoring and tutoring through MIT and Melbourne University, and which was actually really practical to find the direction of practice, because it allowed us to reflect upon what we were doing, why we were doing it, and also with our communication. I'll jump straight in. Part of our introduction and our beginnings is defined by the sawmill app, and as mentioned, a lot of people know us through that project. It's a really good example of what we do. We're very hands-on, and we're not too fussed by final details. And this sort of embodies that. This project was designed by Chris Gilbert for his brother, and the two of them built it together. So Chris quit his job. We were like working in the same practice. He left alone and went to Yak and Dan to build it. It was concurrently also being filmed for Grand Design, which added the element of stress. So Ben Klein was an escort board. So part of the process of his job was very minimal documentation. It was resolved on site with a hand writer. And so apparently the number of times they went through and redesigned their steel was just ridiculous. And so I was saying before, it was a better than definitely a kind of project where Ben could redesign things or redo it so they used it. And a lot of the time it was in the middle of the night when Chris was around. This was as well, Chris and I have been working together in a practice that over the 3 or 4 years we were there, not a single project had been built. So this was just the complete opposite. We were thrown in, Ben as the sort of ideal client. No contracts, no agreements of sorts. It was just, let's just build it, let's make it awesome, and let's have some fun as we do it. So, as I mentioned, it was filmed for Grand Design, and part of the problem with that is they have the editing process, which is also the right to the media, so we weren't allowed to publicise the video in form. So the way that we like to think of it is, really while we know when we have to keep ourselves busy. And that's where our furniture begins, where it's going to start. After actually began, Chris and I were working on 11, and we were trying to detail some quiet time, and we were just getting ridiculous costs. And we're like, let's give it a go ourselves. So early on, we're really trying to get involved with the process and work out how things are actually. So this, whilst at the time we were like, oh, look, we can't publicise it, it was actually a bit of a blessing in disguise because it allowed us to sit down, slow down, and work out what we wanted to do. So as with architectures, we're quite heavily invested in digital means, and so that sort of also flowed across to the digital fabrication. So Chris and I had finished their degree at RMIT, so they knew all about grasshopper rhino and thread. These crazy geometric architectural forms. And so we leveraged that as a means to augment our skill set. We weren't craftsmen. We didn't know how to grow timber, so it would swell, like based on the different properties, the grains. And we learned a lot of trial and error. But we also didn't have to learn as much, which was quite. So as an example here, we've got a pretty obvious sideboard, but for us, this was quite a nice, you know, solid plastic, it was covered in sand, so, but it doesn't look very quickly, just a model. In the background, we've got some, we're also playing at the same time with some glass fibering across paper, GFR2. And what that is it replaces all the meat for Rio with the glass fiber. And we built the mechanicals, I forget what it's called now, and reduces the point of plasticizer. And it reduces the point of work. So what it's doing is it's without having an input steel, you can create these quite intricate and fine forms that you know, you just normally couldn't perform. This is a bit ubiquitous now, but early days, Chris Haddock got really quite involved and came up here actually to Sydney to do a course to know someone from America. It's the first time in Australia. Again, they're pretty, these are small steps of what we were doing, but at the time we were really heavily invested. Like, well, as you've sort of explained really well, in reflection, again, we thought we were stuck. We had photos of this house, this completed, and we've spent and invested a lot of time looking into it, we just couldn't show them. And the blessing in disguise again here was that we started, we had to sort of use the process of publicising us. And that was actually quite good. So rather than being just showing the finished product, practice, or so forth, like, people actually really started engaging just how we were pouring concrete. And, you know, I can remember the day when we had this one, we had 45 bucks, and I was like, that's really split. Not this day, but, and then, you know, early days on Instagram, that was also flowing into a marketplace. It was a really actually exciting time when suddenly you're just posting something for the front and then someone's like, hey, can I buy it? And so early on, this was how these guys were making their living. I hadn't made the point at that point. And then, yeah, media creates media. So the opportunity that we probably wouldn't have been open to was the design part. They definitely do the architecture. But they saw how we were producing things and what they liked. I forget the series they used to do, but it was about the name. So we sort of just largely lucked out in the sense that we were in that group. And again, on reflection, a lot of our clients are coming from this field. It's a slightly separate from coding, you know, getting to architecture. So this was actually a really important part of establishing ourselves and our early clients. So finally, the media, well, brand design ends, and so we were talking to people about the project. We're obviously showing everyone we could the photo, but it's really hard to convince people of architecture, you know, for them to trust you as an architect if you're like, oh, here's so, you know, we don't just make concrete patterns. I'm not sure, I've seen it, and it's, I kind of forget what it was about, it's so long ago, but it was really a defining project. If I go back, sorry, you can see the concrete blocks. They were sort of an accidental discovery where Chris had been passing by a concrete plant, and they had them sitting in the yard, and he's like, right now I need to find a retaining wall slash wall line and it was just that sort of, he was in that frame of mind to juxtapose this terrible landscape box that's sitting in a concrete yard into this is a finished material slash structural element. The screens, whilst they're mine, we've actually been struggling ever since to find it because Ben was willing to take the time. There's very little support, and it's all green, rough sawn, and carpa. And he was expecting it to go off like bananas, but how many years later, the worst deviation is like 20 mil. And if you try to convince a builder these days, it's difficult enough to ask. Internally as well, you know, this is just a little nod to the joinery band. So if we get to know joinery, you specify it, but then it won't ask you, and rightly so, because there are so many do with John Moore. What we were experimenting with here was we're really keen for brass-based joinery. At the time, we talked to a joinery that I'd like to use as a way of double or triple that price. And so what Chris and Dean did, we were developing a highlight, one of our lights at the time. And so we visited their factory and saw the brass shield, which is just like a super thin sheet. But it seems quite obvious that again, the connection clicks. We designed the joiner ourselves the same width, so we could wrap it and glue it. And then you could ask a joiner to do that, but you don't know where the source is coming from. You don't know how to fix it, so they went to a few prototypes. And we came up with quite a very happy product at the end. It was still expensive, but we now know. I guess the problem is that a joiner can't verbalize the sale of the joiner, and that's why they charge us. I guess I've already actually spoken about the blocks, but a sort of accident to our building became quite important for us, and I'll talk more about this a bit later and what they became. So at the same time as the air and green design, the media balance, we'd already set up a few magazines, like Green Magazine and houses, to publish it, but then we were also generally surprised it just sort of went everywhere. Which was really pleasant, and we had put a lot of time and effort into it, so it was nice to sort of finally, this is like 6 months, 8 months later, have a little bit of recognition. And that obviously makes a bit of a spike in project, let's say, so we, what this heat map is showing, it's not just condensed. Previously we had primarily some inner city renovations or roofings. This was really pleasant to see, like, the spark of this strength of projects. We need more projects, we need more space, and more people, which is fun. I'll talk more about that later. Okay, so the main sort of thing that you want to talk about tonight is the building technology. So one of the things that we learned with the sawmill project, as a singular example, we learned it across a number of projects, was it really reinforced.
Does that just mean, what's it cutting out? I think it's just going to be quiet.
What the sawmill sort of epitomizes, it reinforced the value of the documenting process. So we thought design and deliver it on the fly, but when we engage in our reason, you need to pre-think on what your idea is. It also taught us how you don't want to build. If there are a lot of traditional methods that are not necessarily the best ways to build, and that's kind of what Ben exposed us to. And finally, it really drove home the need for a better system. It's such an entrenched way of doing everything. And so this was sort of what really got us started. So I talked about the blocks. This was, it seems quite obvious, but it is one of the elements where you really started to think it's not just a pattern, it's also a structural element, and it's part of the design of the build. Another system that we are very heavily involved in is SIP. So this is structurally insulated panels, and sometimes systems, I don't know. What it is the polystyrene panel that's been laminated with OSB, another thing, oriented scramble. You see, chipboard. And so, what it's both structural and insulated, and it's the panel system. It's the easiest way to describe it. These are all precast in Canada, which sounds a little odd, but over there, OSB is a dime a dozen. A lot of projects in Northern America and Europe are designed buildings, so the economy of scale is just ridiculous. I mentioned before, I think nowadays there are actually some really good ones in Australia, but the main one I'm thinking of is in WA. A few years ago, we did a bit of a comparison, and it was actually cheaper to get it from Canada because shipping and delivery costs are so low. And again, the economy of scale, they pump this stuff out. So, the way that it works is it's just, they're all 1200 wide panels. They've got to study each year. So it's just sort of, rather than start 600 or 1250, it's 1200. So it's a little further. But the biggest benefit about it is the OSB is an airtight, and the polystyrene is consistent. It's not as if someone's got some terrible bats and stuff that he didn't always stick on. So you can sort of see, if we go back, you can sort of make out they're all labelled. They come pre-cut. You put your bottom plates, you run your bottom plates around, you just slide it on top, nail it off, and go away. So this project, I believe, took a week. It was one of the first jobs we've done, but I'm a builder. My place in Hobart, when the floor and the walls went up in a day and the roof panels went on in a day, is I feel as unskilled labour, I could do it again, I could do it in that time as well. It's actually a really simple and very robust system to use. So this project is the 5 house, which this was running concurrently near the sawmill. So this is you can just see that line being covered in snow up down at the back. And the sort of juxtaposition, we have this, which is, you know, along the lines of New Central Modern versus the sawmill house, which has been designed in 15. It was really quite nice at the time, the different problems that we have to achieve, I think, the problem solver is in the exact same process. As I mentioned, the OSB is airtight. You take it up on the outside and you see the performance. So I think I had a little over a few, like over 6 stars, and I'm like, oh, it's not as good as we thought. But the clients walk around in the middle of winter in their shorts and shorts, and it's like a constant 20 degrees. And it really does, it's hard to quantify, but if you have an airtight building, it'll just make a lot of difference. So the example here is the client was.
What they did is it was an old dairy farm, this is where the cows used to golden arc, so it's really up to them. You project it from there. It's a way for them to stay in their house. So,
this is where it's ended up. So we've, at the moment, apparently, I've only seen this point. It's what we're seeing even is. It was, if I can go back there, I didn't forget to mention it. That's the majority of the SIP. And the SIP is the structure. And so we're actually also using the window. So we've been working with a company called Bing to make their own single window frames. And here, there are a few double studs just in the corners. But aside from that, the window frame is going to be roofed up as well. Because the SIP is bi-directional, spreads the loads. With the six spring pre-cut, we really wanted the central courtyard rather than just being a square open, we really wanted the circle to, I'm not the designer, so I don't know if it's justice, but it's more of an obvious thing to sit down. And it's the play of life. And what the SIPs allowed was a computer drew the nice circle and turned up that side. So if someone's not there on the site trying to work out the geometries 3 meters off the ground. And so, you know, this is where we really started to learn some of the cost benefits. Not that you probably all know, we don't really think that. And part of what Betty did as well as me, I'm quite good at drawing, but I just prefer doing it on computers, it's actually easier. And as we mentioned, we started to adapt our documentation process. Rather than the shoulder and 15-19 mm start, we actually ordered in 12 mm and just 10 mm OSB. What that allowed was, because we finally had to do the shop drawings, and that's where they're talking about millimeters and the cross reference, we were just doing the heading. And so this was the early day where we started at least with the structure in the BIM environment. Another technology, let's say, that we would work with is CLT, cross-laminated timber. And so this is effectively like an oversized plywood. So it's got, you can sort of see the layers, they're just layered in different directions. It's, if six is equivalent to the stone with your insulation, this is equivalent to your precast concrete. So it's spread low, but it's a lot. So, so this project is the I'll get some facts about it in a minute. This project's Parks Victoria, which is for the government body. It was in our park in the middle of a park. And what we really want to reflect, they, you know, that they don't have a glamorous job. They're out in the bush, you know, and they enjoy that. So we didn't want them to be in this pristine, you know, highly air-conditioned environment. And what the, in this instance, in the context of CO2-1 is the structural columns and the roof is exposed to finish. And as you can see, we've got the different reflections. CLT, it's pretty gorgeous. I can't skip over that, but we did this in collaboration with Harrison Watt. Stu Harrison, I think he was a lecturer of Chris's University, he hosts renovation or something. He's hilarious. And we came together in terms of our synergies and our skill set. So Stu's practice has a background in sort of commercial and the administration, contract management of a lot of projects. And we've also got the design, the delivery, the documentation. We want this project, the brief. We had a compliant one where the brief called for a separate depot and office, and then we did a non-compliant design solution where we obviously combined the two. And you know, it talks about, it seems really obvious, but because of the formality of the process, everyone felt they had to design two separate buildings. And it was only because we inserted that stuff up into the second one. And they're like, yeah, why didn't we ask for that? So this is as of a few weeks ago. What I'll just sort of vaguely go through this, but fundamentally it's a
building the inner city part. It's right alongside, just to the left there, that's the former Mind Rails track. So half the year it's a part of the pretty near for there. But we really want something that's sort of really process into it. And then as you engage with it, you can sort of see our point of the perfection of the gap, and the builder is freaking out, like, no, that's cool, but it's being used, it's a depot, it's meant to be being used. We don't want it to be this pristine box that just sits there in the landscape. As you can see, that it was early days for the greenery, but there are a few where it starts to really come up. This was, again, we wanted a glass box just so they could really engage with the landscape, but then we've got the heat, cooling, and so forth. And whilst we're lifting the office spaces off the ground so they could get a better view of the park, we're also disconnecting them from it. So this sort of green buffer around the building is doing double time. And it is amazing how quick those lines are going. In the centre, there's a central courtyard, so you sort of mentally it's quite austere and less sensitive element, and it really invites you into the warm box. Here, behind the screen, is the depot. Rather than just hiding it away and telling it doesn't exist, there's a lot of transparency. And so that you can see the movement and the activity straight up through the windows and desks. And again, rather than trying to isolate people in silos, really engage. This is just sort of showing the raw, robust materials, which it took a bit of time being a government agency, but equally so being a parks agency, you know, they understood the proper laws they do. And I was pointing out as well, like, all the services are exposed, so CLT, like the six, you can't hide it all, screw it all away in the wall. And so in this instance, I'll put back here, we, rather than trying to conceal or hide all the services like the shadow said, up in the top right there we just had a cable truck, so everything was just out loud and later on the staff he was wiring it up was like, this is genius, because the amount of time and effort if they ever made a mistake to fix it to make it not invisible, whereas just doing it potentially get access to, and you very much just gloss over it. I stare at it because I think it's great. So this project, I'll quickly show the plan. So you can sort of see, it's pretty bad because this is the doco drawing. There's this ring around the central courtyard, but what we're trying to show here is we're switching our practices, and I documented this all myself. I had a few sleepless nights. And we really need to, let's go to the video because I want to get a little bit of sense, but we decided we needed to let it be in the skill set. And the opportunity is available now. So what this is just going to be a quick space for. Not super interesting, but for us at the time, I guess it's like this. This was just looking at the electrical items, and what I really like about this is it makes me think, it's like looking at the universe and all the stars, like, what are we doing? And if I didn't put that in 3 years and over, I would have worn that many times. At this time, we were very engaged with BMX, which is the 3D mobile iPad, so we walked up to site with this in the field and could see it. And I had to teach you how to turn on his iPad, but at the end of it, he'd run up and go, watch this, and he'd go up to the block, and he was like, yeah, come here, very painfully, walk around the building, get to the wall that they're looking at, and he's like, yeah, see this, be careful of that, and the Bobby's like, oh, yeah, sure. And he's like, you don't understand what just happened, that's just saved me for like half an hour of explaining it, and then half an hour of fixing it, and so yeah, this is where things get started to get exciting, I guess, in my mind at least, with the beat. So, now I'm going to talk about transaction costs. This is going to be a little hard, you know, because I'm the document that has been formed. This is probably a very for me, but this is the typical process of procuring a building. There's the core team, client, architect, and contractor. My team is working to an outcome. And as you can sort of see, this is a simplified version of the generally effect. There's a lot of inputs, you know, geo survey, engineer. And then as you get down to the contractor, all of their subtrades. What I want to talk about this is that each of these interactions has a transaction cost. And that transaction cost is the, you know, the time. So the time, quality, or the market. So in the context of one, you can see just down the side it says 24 to 36 months. Early days, up on the new model, I thought it's 12 months. But we started to track agents, and because of any number of reasons, it was actually 24 to 36. John crunched the numbers the other day, and it's actually 4 years is our average program, which is ridiculous. It's definitely skewed. We've got a few jobs in the office. That's skewing the numbers, like the inner city ones, but it's an issue. In terms of quality, each interaction opens you up to an error. There's like improved communication, misunderstandings, and then also down the end, the physical errors of the building. And then finally, various ones are budget blocks. As we mentioned with the joinery, if someone doesn't understand something, they just generally mark it up. And then it's like, oh, we can't afford this, things change. I forgot to mention as well, the contractor for the Parks Victoria project went bankrupt three quarters of the way through, and they were awesome. They were great, but due to some other jobs and some more, I don't know, management, and that is very rare. It's the one and only time I've heard of it. But it does happen, and that's when it sort of leads to the head contractor had a community to take correctly to their own subjects. So, that's not in the transaction. I don't know what I meant by that. I guess, actually, no, that's right. So, if you step back a bit, we're going to try and understand what's happening here. Fundamentally, this doesn't apply for every job, but the client is looking for an outcome. They're not clear. The way to think of it is, rather than, we like to think of it, or get lost in the fact that we've been engaged to design a home. We've actually been engaged to deliver an outcome. And you can sort of imagine there's ourselves, there's all the other people involved, and head contractor, they're busy themselves because they think that's what they need to be doing. And you lose track of the bigger picture that the client just wants an outcome. There are definitely anomalies. We have a client in Hobart that just wants to build. He's a very good three-job. He's a grand design for Hobart one. But he's a sucker for pain. It went massively over budget. And he's using the exact same building again. And it's massively over budget. But you know, this is really weird. There's a book. There's a book, it's a little hard to read, so I'll just try to paraphrase it, but there's a book by Michael Munger called Tomorrow 3.0, and it's about transaction costs in the sharing economy. He uses the example of the power grid. So in the US, apparently, let's say, I think there's about 80 million power grids, which is just ridiculous, and they have an average lifespan of 30 minutes. What he talks about in that context is, when you think about it, the transaction cost in that example is the power grid. Fundamentally, someone just wants a hole in the wall. They don't want a power grid. But we get distracted when we go to a power grid. You don't own a power grid, you've got to dark it. You've got to store it. They have costs. And that's the sort of mentality we've really been trying to think about. How and what we're doing. So we talked about pain, notice and sound. It's a really interesting book, but where it sort of goes to is fundamentally we want to try to reduce transaction costs. It's not about reinventing this process. It's about the effort margin gains. So effectively picking your battles, working out where you can get increased efficiencies and streamline things. So an example of that is the government. So Chris tells me stories, so he's a little bit of myself, but they did a cost analysis, and they worked out that 60% of their time cost for the manufacturing company went into the small pickle box component of a car. So what they did is, rather than completely redesigning the system and looking at that, they just decided to set that as a uniform item across their range. And everything else is there. So I think this is true with every car, every one of the cars is identical there, but they all look completely different. So this is sort of an example of, in terms of simplifying and unifying elements, it doesn't necessarily have to have an aesthetic or a design or an emotional outcome that constrains the building. So with that in mind, over the last 6 or so months, it was actually after we did this graph for last year's talk, so it's a year out later, but this really is sort of a locus to what had happened unintentionally. So early on in 2015, this is quarterly, early in this time last year. Early in 2015, we had a spike in projects, so the staff rose. And as you can see, the average fee and rate is the same. Effectively saying that we just had more staff, and the same amount of work is the same. The peak occurs in early 2017, and that's just after the completion of the parks project where we also this is awesome, let's give it a go. So we definitely started to trickle down into our everyday jobs, and up until that point we were on the same mindset that it's just not worth it for the smaller jobs. But as you can sort of see, what actually occurred was it allowed us to, well actually sorry, concurrently we discovered, I think we peaked at 15 or 16 million. The force of us became managers rather than designers or documents. You know, we were just bouncing between client meetings, or I was just doing payroll, or, you know, and that's not what we thought. And so we made a choice to slowly downsize. So we, you know, coincidentally, we didn't plan to do this. The efficiencies we were getting from being and streamlining our systems and shows you where to pick our battles, really actually led to an uptick. So the average fee and wage actually increased whilst the staff increased. So, obviously, wrap it on a little bit about it. Let's talk about fees. We're going to start really high level, just in case people aren't fully aware, but building information modeling. And I guess straight up, it's not just a 3D model. Some people think it's, you know, SketchUp is doing sometimes, but it's part of the, I don't know if you call it a system or a process, but it's built it twice. And we effectively have a dry run in a digital model, and we build it on site. And what that allows is you to better quantify, coordinate the process, which ultimately leads to a better outcome. So going back to that idea of just designing for the sake of design, this isn't about modeling for the sake of modeling. We've got an end goal, we're trying to have a project non-budget design as we want to without any flaws that arise during the building process. So, as I said, it's not just a pretty model. So this is showing you like just the structural elements. So this is a communication tool, it's a quantifying tool. And likewise for the object. So, you know, it might sound like we're modeling, you know, 3D now pipes that are scheduled and quantified with all the track lights, different pipe appliances for, and so forth. So, B in our sense can be broken down to sort of input and output at a basic level. Going through the story in the context of Archicad, which I think people are familiar with, but we're starting with services, surfaces. You know, in this instance, I'll try to respond to a grid. So we give it a hatch, it's just a visual thing, and then communication. We then apply that to a building material. So as you can see on the left, we've got a database of very consistent, a selection of materials that we use very consistently. And that's part of a conscious decision we've made not to try to reinvent the wheel over time. On the right, you know, that surface is applied to it, and we choose a hatch for individual things. But then, where it gets interesting is you can see what the property is. down the middle here, we've got a bit of bone and a description. And that's what it tells you, the description of the animals. What else do you know about that? The building materials are the kind of parts and then brick, obviously. So this is where we've used that singular brick to, you know, it's a 110mm brick veneer, 40mm pattern, 1mm of wall siding. And I can remember the first time I put the wall siding, someone's like, you're crazy, you know, but I can use quantify and we need to think about the implications and the ramifications of using it. And it is actually really important. Some builders still don't think they need it, which is just one of the things. You don't need to spend some of your sound favourites. So you're not constantly getting a tap, setting the height you want, the rotation, the brand. And so you can see we've set up one of our favourites in the pack well. We've got some Blanco, the Blanco gap we don't use, but you know, that sort of rounds out what we do. From there, at a very basic level, we're outputting the typical floor plan and the typical section. Being a live model, these sections are cut where we need them, which might sound up, sure, but when you're on site and a builder's like, what's happening right here? We can cut the model to that point, but just go to the line. Otherwise, you know, there's so much detail. It's also a minefield. You can get lost in the model, and there is a bit of an art to working out what we will and won't do. And so with this, you know, in terms of workflow, it's a live model, all the things that model, because we have to communicate and check it with the engineer, like the look like I'm doing the steel models. We've got a few RL markers and detail markers, other levels fine. I don't know how to name it, so I'm going to pull it out of this. Here we're looking at an electrical paint, so because we have these objects, the track light, that's a simple one thing. The tracking light, we're not only giving it a code, a description of manufacturer. We can also, again, we just started doing this recently, the ADAR communication, is we start to color code lighting. We've also got a smoke detector, tough lighting, and the resolution doesn't show it. But common items that we think, oh, sure, they'll find it, but again and again, you're on site and there's something in the wrong place, because like, I didn't think you had a smoke detector. You know, it's annoying. Something we take for granted, so I'll just kind of put this in there as a reason, is a window shield. If you model it in there, we actually model the thickness of the frame to set out, because again, we've been caught in situations where it's swing won't open. We use a lot of tooth terms, but it's actually, they have to tooth in, they can't tooth out. And we just assume, oh, let's tooth it out. So this is sort of maybe just some other basic things in there as well. The build-up schedule. So again, we've spent this time and effort creating the composites. And at some point you've got to tell the builder, I want 110mm brick, and you know, what are we adding and siding? So we've got to move the model while we've drawn some lines. You've got to communicate that. You can either dimension it or architect it into a schedule and which is awesome. And then just finally, this is a bit of a segue where, you know, again, it's kind of obvious scheduling for the objects. This is the plane scheduler. It's the basin at the top. You can see that code, the name. It's also counted how many are in a project. And again, it's a small thing, but the number of electricians will just throw a number because they're like, I don't know how many kids, I'm not going to count them. I'll just throw a number. This gives an accountability. So early on, we don't do so much anymore because a lot of electricians in combat are kind of expecting to do so. But early on, we'd say, show us how many you allow, and we'd say, there's only five, so why are you not 20? Doesn't have this open. The segue here as well, it really brings back into this loop in terms of the cost, because on the far right, we can apply a price. So at the bottom of this sheet, it's summing all the plumbing items, summing all the electrical items, power rails, etc. And then also the building material. So it's not only just telling you how many screens you can apply it across. We found it's easy to export to Excel, you have a database, close it in, you've got a cost. Likewise with the beams, we can actually do that very accurately. timber and their steel are volume based and weight based generally. So very rough people we can cross those things. We can't cross labour. It's a magical box. All of these things I just want to show there, they're just small marginal gains. So a lot of them we take for granted these days, but they are actually quite important in the bigger picture. So from there, that's sort of where we ended up last year. That's what we've been doing. Since last year we touched base, we've been exploring the preservation of the 3D model. And so the sheds are great, so are all the colored plans, but there's still a 3D model or data. It's a data set that's been dumped into a two-dimensional model, a plan or a spreadsheet and so forth. So we found a plugin about a year ago, really going nuts with it. And what it allows is the other element that wasn't being priced was the material, the frame. And so as you can sort of see, rather than just the really dumb slabs, we've got, we've actually got the walls broken up. The studs are the correct sensors. We've got the old speed. You can see it actually counts the sheets. It puts the nails on. And interestingly, then there's a plugin that's just mind blowing. It produces this volume. So you run around, you trace your walls, add the plugin, and literally, for this project, we had a fully documented, ready to this level, for 3.5 hours. And we've gone and spoken to a few manufacturers that have these crazy machines, I'll show you in a second. And, their jaw just dropped. They spend like a week sometimes. Not just, this is a pretty small thing, but they just couldn't believe in 3.5 hours something that they would have spent maybe a day or two on this. And that's just the 2D one. What this is actually doing is we can put files saved as and it exports it to the Hyundai bar, which is awesome. So this is a crazy machine from Germany, a dude called Hans Hyundai. So this machine, it puts it in, actually let's go to the video because that's mind-blowing. So what we can do is we can export those frames, and then file send as a certain file type, the big PDX, and then this machine will read it. Being a labourer or an apprentice on site trying to try to demonstrate, I can really appreciate that. So these people we actually spoke to, I went last Monday, so it's pretty recent. Went down to the company just out of Detroit, and they were the first people to come in and kind of get to experience, you know, you can't quite well. So the first simple process is you grab your model, you get select all your frame, say that is a PDX or whatever. That machine cuts it all, you can label it, you can pencil mark it, you package it up, and then you take it to the framing table. This is a different company, Homad. They have a brand of machines called Winders. This is sort of stuff you see in brand design. They're tucked around Australia, they're trust manufacturer, and they just don't know what to do this. And what we'll do is we'll grab all the timber, we'll run it in, and then the machine in the background is the nailing machine, and that'll run around, lay a sheet of OSB on it, and it'll nail it up all in place. It runs down, flip it, they can fill up all the insulation, do it again, and at the end of the day, you've got, this is only a small part of the building, but what we've been finding in it was, it's a bit like a sieve, but on a grander scale in the sense, and look, sure, it's more expensive, it's just the plate displacing stud insulation, but what it allows is a better envelope and a longer term gains. What we're finding we can do with this is we can cut, because we've got all the objects with power points, we can cut them out so that there's not a sparking right around with a tape measure and a whole sort of. getting it wrong, a machine that cut it. And so, in isolation, sure, but in the bigger picture, what are you trying to do here? You're trying to deliver an outcome for a client. And so, you know, just assuming that the sparker has to deliver it. So, a few builders, we've got two builders running cars in the story that are very excited. They already understand that what will allow is they could potentially run around with their apprentice and put it all off, and then the sparker can come along and just, I don't know, I think it's close. The sparker can just spit it off. And again, marginal gains, you can look at creative destruction and so forth. What will allow, what these builders understand, what they're really excited about is it's not about being the sparker losing their job or so forth. It means their quality and their output will increase, much like our diagram earlier on. So at the moment, you know, this is what is a typical process, as I sort of spoke to you before. Imagine that 36-month crashes since forward. But what we feel we're working towards is a platform that could turn around in 12 months. We've got fixed time frames, we're not trying to completely run into it, so still 100% efficient. But we're cutting parties out, which is cutting communication out, which is reducing the transaction costs. So we just don't want to do the electrician styles and joining, so we get a project moving in there. But importantly, we can communicate with suppliers. So previously, we were a few steps removed, all the way down the bottom, blurred out. And this is something through the furniture we've already engaged in, and we understand, we're comfortable. There's a bit of humility, you need to know when you're going to wear something. But then there's also another important one is eagerness and just interest. So we can turn up to, there's some suppliers, the guys are saying, I have to stop going with email, because some suppliers just couldn't believe that we were interested in what they were doing. And that in itself can really, again, reduce transaction costs. Just quickly, some further reading of sorts. Tomorrow 3.0 is awesome. I'm only halfway through it, and so on my mind. Flight to the City is coming up this week. And I haven't read the other two, but Chris thinks I will.
Thank you very much, Josh. It was fascinating. I was, the preview before showing, I was just to see, it was just an amazing looking at how you use technology and you sort of, you know, hijacking it in a way and making it work for you rather than what tends to be the feeling amongst the profession and everybody that it's, you know, they're being taken advantage of by technology, learning the technology, which is what it's meant to do, work for you. So that's really bad. I'd like to open up to any questions. Has anyone got any questions for me? Hang on, I'm running with my phone.
Instead of the start, I'll open up saying you don't take a fuss on the little things, but then when I look at your BIM model, everything is modeled and it's the finest detail. So are you able to talk about how you see the shifting of responsibilities towards from the builder to the architect, and maybe how that is, you communicate that up to the client? That's actually a really good question, I hate to say that. But that is fundamentally what we're doing, and it's a lot of the resistance we get is, well, why would you want that? It's too much risk. You know, I'm not planning that. I definitely didn't say we're not focusing on the little things, and I'm terrible at that because I do it. But I just sort of, and again, I'm doing a lot of this stuff consciously, so in terms of running through this, I do realise they do something because one time we got screwed over and it actually had it work. So I don't know what one of those examples was, but when you look at a schedule like this, the small things might be, okay, we've got the diameter of the waste and so forth, but
so
the problem is with cockroaches.
That will happen. Yeah, that might be a small one, but again, if the planet puts it on the flat thunder, that actually, I've skipped over a lot. That object is communicated with heat, communicated with time, it's communicated in a slab set out, or it's communicated with a planning plan. And what that's saying is it's communicated with hot air. So a lot of things that might seem small, I guess over time, they're not actually small. Like I still get this place in the plumbing schedule, I like it. But it was actually for a number of times that we've been in the place. So the other question about in terms of risk, when we come back to, again, we're trying to think bigger picture. There's a lot more risk there, and we're not spreading a lot. But equally so, when you look at this, we're already taking on a lot of the risk. We specify the fees. And if you get on site, like, I'm sharing my top five things, but the project when we put in the HRV system, heat recovery effect, which is so well sealed, UV fresh air. And we, you know, in previous lives, we learned the modeling because there's a lot of stick in the UV system. So we remove all the dates. And the plant was so like, why did we do that? You know, they went negative or then we got on site a few months later and the plumber that was the unity was like, oh, how is this going to work? And then half an hour later, the vent person, I think model two, he came and asked the exact same question and I just went straight to the model, like, oh, sure, job. So already, if you specify the hot water system, like a HRV system, you're already taking on a bit of risk because if that can't fit, or if there's problems with it, you're the one to specify, you're the one to say it would work here. And in this job, there is no spare room, so we can't just hide things around the corner. And so that's where I feel we're already taking on all the risk, so let's just do it now.
Okay.
years. So I jumped up.
We don't ask a lot of you to show us to come up, but we already do all their work. So this job, which, well, as in we do that,
yeah.
And they largely just mark it up and ticket and produce it.
They certify it.
Don't get me wrong, they don't take responsibility for this. But,
again, not
no, but again, it's if you go to the other diagram, you definitely make engaging people. But we already engage the engineer. If the engineer falls off the face of the earth, we let's say told the client to use and engage this engineer, and that holds the project up for months. I believe they can finish this service. I don't know. It happens. But again, it's one of those sort of things where we already are responsible. And what we're finding, as I sort of said, is there are sandcoders for timber. And with this project, this was awesome. We did a pretty simple one. We did it all, and they just said, yeah, sure. And they just threw it to count. But we're finding that there's nothing crazy here. We're not doing germs or campings. Even if we are, I don't know how we find the campings. But that design of the group, that was us going, yeah, let's do this one. And yeah, sure. It's actually a really good point. We're a small practice in the field of architecture, which is a small lithium layer of what the project is. And this is a regular build. It's six. We're actually moving a little away from six because the new one we're calling it fit, not a five, but it's more flexible. But in terms of fairness, it's nothing. And this system that we're going through, so this is what we're calling a small mill. This is only going to suit a small portion of the population, and it's not going to replace all of our jobs. It's kind of like we have a lot of clients coming to us at the moment, and we're just like, your budget doesn't allow flat out. And we've had a few clients where we went through the entire documentation process of wasting days in the market, so delivering a project, and then it just doesn't get off the ground. And again, that's a bit self-centered in itself, but we do invest a lot in what we do. And so this is what I mean, it's for the client, it's for ourselves. This will solve their problem. So we've got five clients that they can't afford what they want, but they are very interested. This is just a skeleton of it, by the way. Let's talk about this.
I think what's really interesting here is away. Well, firstly, thank you for showing us your process. Kind of like you're talking about with the grand design thing and showing the process. I think far too often we just see the few photos that you look at it done. And given that this whole series is called Practice Mode, actually talking about how you practice, I think really valuable. So thank you for that. And I think the questions that you've gotten start to show that. But on to what I found really interesting about the way you're talking about skin is coming from the context of a small practice. So the way that you're talking about it is the way my experience working on a large practice on a quite large multi-million-dollar project where there's an economy to the scale to do these things. I find it really interesting the way that they're dropping off in place of flashy at a small scale. And we've had a couple of practices come in and talk a little bit about
while I pack up all infrastructure, and while I ask you questions.
But I'd say, you know, following up from Tim's comment, I'd say thanks very much, and on behalf of the School of Architecture, which will come visit tomorrow, and